Despite spending our entire lives bathed in the Earth's atmosphere, only when something's wrong with it do we pay much attention, even though it's the most basic thing keeping us alive. But as far as planetary atmospheres go, Earth is the weirdest and most unlikely atmosphere we've yet seen. This is because this is not the first atmosphere Earth has had. In fact, our current one is number 3. When Earth formed, its original atmosphere would have been the gases it collected from the solar nebula. This atmosphere would have been composed primarily of hydrogen, but also may have contained water vapor, methane, and ammonia. Earth could not hold on to this atmosphere, and it would have been slowly eroded into space and was then blown away by the solar wind. Earth's second atmosphere would have formed slowly from then on from several sources for atmospheric gases such as volcanism, and that which was delivered by comets and asteroids during the late heavy bombardment. This atmosphere is thought to have largely been made up of nitrogen and CO2, kicking off Earth's carbon cycle. Life must have developed very quickly in this changing environment because we have evidence of its activities going back as far as 3.5 billion years. But that leaves us with somewhat of a fundamental mystery. The Sun has not always been as bright as it is today. In fact, it continues to brighten and will eventually cook Earth if we don't do something about that millions of years from now. But early in the Earth's history, about the time of the second atmosphere, the Sun's output was only about 70% of what it is now. That's not enough to maintain a liquid ocean on Earth. So how could life arise without liquid water? This is called the faint young sun paradox and remains one of the great unknowns of early Earth. Despite the weaker sun, the geologic record shows that things were relatively warm, other than one or two severe cold snaps that may have nearly frozen Earth over. But most of the time it was warmer, and we don't know why things were so temperate. Several hypotheses exist. It may be that carbon dioxide was more common early in Earth's history than today and was acting as a greenhouse gas. Methane may have performed a similar role, but it could also have had a weirder source. Geothermal heating, coming from the decay of radioactive isotopes, seems to have been much higher than it is today. Much of this occurs in the core, but there also would have been deposits of uranium ore near the surface that could have contributed in a bizarre way to Earth's temperatures, and they may have done this through nuclear fission. We tend to think of nuclear fission as an entirely technological phenomenon limited to atomic bombs and nuclear reactors, but, like fusion, it appears that it can occur naturally under the right circumstances. The ratios of uranium-235 and 238 at the time in these deposits seems to have been similar to modern low-enriched uranium. So if you have water present to moderate the reaction, then a natural nuclear fission reactor becomes hypothetically possible, and it's thought we may have found evidence of one. In 1972, isotope evidence of a nuclear chain reaction was found in central West Africa. About 1.8 billion years ago, it appears that a sustained reaction occurred when groundwater came into contact with uranium. As soon as the groundwater dried up, the reaction stopped, leaving isotopes in the deposit indicative of nuclear reactions. It may be that this sort of thing was once common on Earth, with near-surface nuclear reactors helping to keep the planet warmer than it would have been with a weaker solar output. I would be remiss if I didn't address the obvious question here. Can a natural nuclear bomb exist? It's highly unlikely to occur, but in principle could be possible if you slam two uranium-rich bodies, such as an asteroid, into a planetary uranium deposit and the right conditions are met. This honestly doesn't seem likely, but, while not widely accepted, there is a hypothesis in a paper out there that the moon may have formed when a natural nuke near the Earth's core went off. The standard and likely model for how the moon was formed is basically that an impactor about the size of Mars smacked into Earth and essentially knocked the material off that went and formed the moon. But if this was the case, models show that the moon should be composed of around 80% material from the impactor and about 20% material from the Earth. However, this is not the case. Isotope ratios and other evidence indicate that the moon is very similar to Earth, rather than being an uneven mix of two planets. In a paper by Dutch scientists Meijer and Westerinen linked below, they hypothesized that instead of an impactor, heavy molten radioactive elements near the Earth's core might have concentrated and reached supercriticality, literally blowing a massive blob of Earth off into space, thus forming the moon. This paper has not been widely accepted, and I wouldn't worry about Earth suddenly exploding in an atomic explosion. But back to Earth's atmospheres. Earth's third atmosphere, the one we have now, is the atmosphere of life, but also plate tectonics and the carbon cycle. The oxygen we have first appears during a mass extinction event known as the Great Oxygenation Event about 2.4 billion years ago. Before this time, the oxygen the plants were producing was taken from the atmosphere through the oxidation of iron. When the iron ran short, the oxygen began to accumulate, eventually poisoning much of the anaerobic life on this world. Since that time, the oxygen levels of Earth have varied, going as high as 35%, significantly higher than today's 21%. The reasons for these variations are not well understood, but volcanism is thought to play a role through the release of sulfur into the atmosphere. The history of Earth's atmosphere has implications on exoplanets and the development of life in the universe. On worlds where oceans are locked inside shells of ice, such as Europa, or rogue planets where geothermal heat allows for liquid water but there's no star present, then photosynthesis couldn't develop, and thus no oxygenation of the atmosphere. This may preclude such worlds from ever developing complex life. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently imagining dubious exoplanets. There might be worlds where they produce too much oxygen, and the aliens can't harness fire without their civilization getting reset. I think I'll go eat a pineapple in a show of solidarity, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.